It's clear that AI is having a moment, maybe more than a moment, and it's been evolving over a long time, but roughly 2 years ago with the advent of Chat GPT, everybody suddenly said, wait a minute, this thing actually works.
And should that have been a surprise to us? And I guess that's a short way of asking how long artificial intelligence has been in our lives and perhaps governing our lives without us realizing it.
AI's been in our lives for a very long time, but people should feel fine if they're surprised, because I was surprised. Many AI people were surprised. I've spoken to business leaders at the most major corporations, and they were surprised. So I think that it's one of these things where it moves along, and then suddenly reaches a tipping point, and that's what happened here.
And so that tipping point that we first began to experience 2 years ago, where do you see its intersection in our lives and how it's going to change our lives?
It is the case that we're already using AI in lots of different ways and not even aware of it. When you use a search engine like Google, it's using AI. You get a recommendation from Spotify or Amazon, that's using AI. Your word processor is using AI, smartphone camera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. What's changed now is that there's a new set of AI capabilities that you see in ChatGPT to summarize documents, read documents, create drawings, even write software that's completely new. And so I think it's basically going into overdrive.
Is there a reason that this escalated so quickly?
It's a confluence of reasons. One of them has to do with the availability of computation. There's just so much. The computers nowadays are so much more powerful than ever before. A second reason has to do with the long-standing efforts of some brilliant people to figure out how to make these types of algorithms work. And the third one is the collection of enormous amounts of data. So ChatGPT almost literally has read every single sentence on the internet, the transcript of millions of YouTube videos, et cetera, et cetera. And it turns out that this combination of some brilliant algorithms with a tremendous amount of compute and data is a rather magic elixir.
And one that comes with a lot of fear on a lot of people's parts, because they realize the extent to which ChatGPT and other platforms can do what we thought we could do singularly as humans, write essays, process information, create art. That's being done in seconds now by algorithms.
I think that there are two kinds of concerns, very broadly speaking. The first one is what might be described as an existential concern. That's AI is going to take over the world. You alluded to AI running the world. AI is going to take over the world, maybe keep us as pet, or maybe discard us like used tissue paper. I think that's very unrealistic, because these AI systems, while very powerful, are still tools that are there for us to use. That said, the tools are incredibly powerful. They're power tools. And as a result, technology, the progress of powerful technology, does create disruption in society. It affects jobs. It affects privacy. Many things are going to be disrupted here. And so the concerns there are valid. You mentioned art in particular. A local artist in Seattle listened to some AI-generated music, and he said, it sounds like wet cardboard. So I wouldn't give up on my artistic career quite yet. I think Taylor Swift is going to be just fine. But it is the case that it's empowering for artists. So I can't draw, I can't hold a tune, but for the first time, I can actually be a lot more creative in visual and musical arts than ever before. So like so many things with technology, it's two sides of the coin.
Well, I was just going to say, yes, I feel like everything with artificial intelligence is yes and. So that part is certainly true, that it gives people an entirely new set of tools. People who wouldn't have that facility, I would count myself in that category, can create art through a different mechanism, through keystrokes and conjuring images that you enter into the algorithm. However, there's also the other side, where so many artists are calling out AI right now because it has scavenged the internet, consumed all of these images produced by artists, whether it be paintings or photography or other art produced and it's creating its own images, and people are saying, well, wait a minute, this is my artistic property. These are my intellectual rights and I should have copyright protection. How do the two coexist?
Yes, and. So I very much agree with that idea. First of all, copyright needs to be protected, and there are lawsuits in place trying to work that out through the legal system. But as you alluded to, there's also an ethical question. Maybe I'm an artist and I don't have fancy attorneys. What are my rights? Can AI just be trained on whatever I've put out there? And I think as a society, we need to agree. We need to come to some sort of compact as to what's fair and what's appropriate. And frankly, artists are in a tough spot already with Spotify and services like that, often paying them quite a bit less, even when their copyright is protected, than previously. I think as a society, we need to decide how much support we want to give to the arts and to the artists, and how do we deliver that, rather than let technological progress just run them over.
Well, this is another concern too, that AI, of course, is going to affect us literally the world over. And how do we establish guardrails for the development of AI? How does that happen? Where and by whom does it happen?
Well, there are very different ways to try and make this happen. Usually when people talk about that, their mind immediately goes to regulations, right? Well, we should have the right regulations. And of course, the EU is way ahead of us in these regulations. I like to say that the road to regulatory hell is paved by the EU's well-intentioned regulations. So it is very tricky to create the right set of regulations. And certainly the EU has done a terrible job, and we could get into examples of that. And so I just think that regulation is not a panacea. Regulations are often distorted by lobbyists. It's very difficult to regulate technology because it's moving so fast. So regulations from even 2 years ago wouldn't apply to what we see today with generative AI, Chat GPT, and so on. I think that what we really need is a broad social dialogue to understand the technology. People need to become more conversant with what it can and can't do and how. I'm not saying people all need to study computer science, right? But it's you need to spend your 10 hours at least. If you haven't spent 5 to 10 hours with ChatGPT, really taking it through its paces, and I don't mean ChatGPT, right? I don't work for OpenAI, ChatGPT or Claude or Google Gemini, but one of these systems, so you understand what it does well and what it does badly. If you haven't done that, you're not doing your job as a citizen. We need to do that, and then we need to decide as a society what we allow and what we don't, in the context of the fact that, of course, it's an international phenomenon. So if we all decide in Boston or Massachusetts or even the US that this is how we want things to happen, we have to take into account what the Chinese are doing, what the Iranians are doing, et cetera, et cetera.
If we leave it to society, not everybody has the aptitude for computer science, not everybody even has the access to be able to understand ChatGPT, to even log on to it. How do we come together as a society to make those decisions if there's that kind of inequity?
Well, I would say that a lot of these things are not technical. They're societal problems. What is the role for arts in society is not a technical problem. You don't need to be an expert in AI to understand that artists ought to be treated fairly. You don't need to be an expert in AI to think about privacy, surveillance, capitalism, to think about how our attention is being hijacked by Facebook and TikTok and other things. So I do think that everybody needs to participate. I also really believe that everybody needs access to these tools. I think internet access should be a fundamental right. I worry about some of our fellow citizens who are denied basic rights like healthcare and so on, but you can go to a public library and you can use it. And at this point, this AI is pretty much as ubiquitous as internet access. You do have to remember, and this is a remarkable thing, that the tools that we're talking about are actually free to use. Maybe not at the highest, most advanced levels, but you can get access to generative AI, ChatGPT, for free, which is actually pretty amazing.
And I think partly for that reason, you have argued that we are likely to see an economic boon because of AI. Is that in the job sector, marketplace? Where do you see that happening? Is it widespread for the population?
One of my favorite ways to understand what's going to happen going forward is to look backwards. So if you look backward over the last 50 years, infant mortality, life expectancy, many aspects of our lives, our economic well-being have improved due to productivity growth, due to the fact that the same workers can produce more food, more of many things. And that is due to technology, especially computer technology. And now we have a new generation of computer technology called artificial intelligence, or AI, which many of us believe will lead to substantial, is actually already leading to substantial increased productivity that will then translate to substantial increased growth in our society. And now we get, again, to the societal question. We need to decide, as a society, how to distribute that newfound wealth.
In terms of jobs, do you see it augmenting jobs? And what's the risk of it taking away jobs, eliminating jobs entirely?
In the short term, it's going to make, and it is making, people more productive. That rapidly does translate to job loss in some sectors, and it could happen quite rapidly, right? We're always having job loss. It used to be that 98% of the country worked in agriculture, and now it's something like 1% to 2%. So that's inevitable that there will be job loss and job disruption. The question is, what is the pace? And what happens with the people who do lose their jobs? We need to find other jobs, retrain them, or find ways to appropriately let them be contributing citizens of our society.
You started off the conversation by saying that this is a tool, basically, that is controlled. Is there any risk, has this already happened, that AI has become sentient?
Such an important point. I'm really glad you brought this up. And we won't have time in this brief conversation to get into all the details. So I will just rely on hopefully my credibility and that of my colleagues to tell you absolutely not. This is a tool. It's a fancy calculator, very fancy calculator, but it is not sentient. It is not human. It does not have free will. Here's one way to illustrate this. You know, I asked Chat GPT, hey, what do you do between queries? It said, nothing. It just sits there. Does that sound like a sentient being to you? Now, of course, people say, oh, maybe it's lying to you. It's not. I know people who work at OpenAI. It just sits there. So the fact of the matter is that we tend to anthropomorphize. We tend to take even our toaster and be like, hey, why are you doing that to me? You know, come on. Yesterday you were better. It's a very natural human tendency, but this technology is just that. It's technology, it's computers, it is not sentient.
I want to spend our last couple of minutes talking about the efforts you have made to look at disinformation, the disinformation campaign, especially through an election year. You had a whole project, truemedia.org, which was examining elections and campaigns and what candidates were doing. And I guess anyone with access to the ability to create deep fakes was doing across the world. Now that 2024 is over, what did you ultimately find?
In 2024, as many as 2 billion people went to the polls in Indonesia, Brazil, Taiwan, India, and of course in the US, all over the world. In every election, deep fakes were present. They were viewed by hundreds of millions of people, if not more. And the exact impact they had is controversial. I come away from that experience thinking that we need to do better at identifying and managing them, not necessarily taking them off the internet, but avoiding having them hoodwink people in political contexts and scams and so on, because unfortunately the worst is yet to come. The technology of creating these fakes is getting better. It's become so easy to do it. Like we saw with the fake Biden robocall in the New Hampshire primary. One person, who wasn't a technical person, created this very authentic sounding fake call of Biden telling people not to vote. This can and will happen again, and we need to be ready.
And I think about that often. So we're talking about this now. We know that it was fake. Within days, it was reported that that was fake. When do we hit a point where it becomes lasting information that people think that actually happened? And we probably know there are people in New Hampshire who believe they really had those calls from Joe Biden when they didn't.
I think that we're not going to be able to solve the problem of people believing false things, right? And that's rampant, not just due to AI, due to social networks, due to human nature. What I'm worried about is that the Biden robocall was one thing, and as you said, we got a handle of it within days. What happens if there's a tsunami of disinformation? What happens if using AI, people can create so much mayhem, so much disinformation of different kinds that we really struggle to tell what's real and what's not? That's what I'm most worried about.
We so feared that was going to happen. We had the examples. New Hampshire was one example. The fake Taylor Swift video on behalf of Donald Trump was another example. But that was not the full extent of it, but that was largely what we saw happen. Those were two of the most striking examples. Why didn't more happen?
I'm going to give you a very honest and direct answer to that. I really don't know. The ingredients were there. Somehow they did not come together. But the fact that it didn't happen by no means should make us complacent that it's not going to happen in 2 years or in 4 years. The pieces are there. We can't afford to fight the last war. We have to be prepared for the next one.
And final question, going back to AI, as you say, it's here. We all have to accept it, whether we like it or not. As you say, there are benefits. What's the final parting word you want to leave for people who know that this is time to start living with it?
I do want to highlight the piece of what you said, which is not spoken about enough. The tremendous potential benefits, right? We have so many conversations about the problems and the concerns are real. But what about reducing accidents on our roads, 40,000 highway deaths? What about reducing physician error in hospitals, millions of misdiagnoses in emergency rooms? What I say to people who are feeling, oh God, another thing to deal with is sooner or later, AI will save your life or the life of somebody near and dear to you.
Oren Etzioni, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you.